dollar bills printed on toilet paper, and you've got that.
Hey, Jimmy, where are you going? I'm reading Moby Dick. I'll be there for a while.
Well, that's a great idea.
My boss, definitely.
Books on rolls.
Why can't we have
Jesus? Books on rolls. Barnes has just
He's
struck.
Losing it now.
Man,
he is losing and Barnes is
I'm trying to think of something to retire with. That could be it.
That is it. You have struck.
The whole, put Roots. You got like the big 12 package. You got Roots.
Roots. A volume. You could have.
Volume.
You could have the Encyclopedia Britannica in the bathroom.
Oh, man, I'm in tears. Okay.
You know, you go down and get some Mexican food. Read the whole volume in one sitting.
The Morning X with Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy.
It feels like it's natural. You know, I don't have the after effects. I don't have the smell.
New Rock 99X.
Music. Guster.
A Boston trio.
That is two acoustic guitars and a bongo player.
This is Guster and the Airport Song.
99X.
Music.
Glad you made it. Welcome to the farm. Who's your daddy? I'm your daddy now.
So I tell him I'm a pro, Jack. And who do you think they give me? The Dalai Lama himself, the 12th son of the Lama, the flowing robes, the grace, bald, striking. So I'm on a first tee with him. I give him the driver. He hauls off and whacks one, big hitter, the Lama, long, into a 10,000-foot crevice right at the base of this glacier. Do you know what the Lama says?
No.
Gunga Galunga. Gunga, gunga, gunga. So we finish 18, and he's going to stiff me. And I say, hey, Lama, hey, how about a little something, you know, for the effort, you know? And he says, there won't be any money. But when you die on your deathbed, you will receive total consciousness. So I got that going for me, which is nice.
The Morning X.
New Rock 99X, the best of the Morning X. Blues Traveler, Hook. Todd the Butler, your host for the best of Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy. 10 minutes in front of 11 o'clock. Coming up next, something out of the Morning X archives. We'll listen to that next and enjoy yourselves this morning. It's a beautiful day. Well, it will be. Trust me.
Well, my brother's girlfriend was in Blind Willie's a couple of weeks ago, and there's a couple of guys over sitting in the corner kind of, you know, looking at her, and one of them was wearing a Braves uniform. And she'd been sitting there a while, and she's a really good-looking girl. And at one point, the companion of the guy who was dressed in regular clothes came over and said, "Hey, how would you like to meet John Smoltz? Is this, you know, like a big deal and everything?" Mm-hmm. And basically, long story short, she said no thanks and all that. But I just thought that was kind of pitiful that if that was really him, that he'd be sitting in Blind Willie's sending someone else to pick up women.
You think John Smoltz is going to be in his uniform at Blind Willie's?
I mean, I know what you're saying, that it sounds just like impossible. But if you look at Smoltz, and he's not the best-looking guy in the world.
Oh, dude.
Hey, let me tell you something. $5 million looks good to a lot of women.
I know you're right.
I don't think he needs to wear his uniform out in...
But I can see a lonely John Smoltz sitting over there after batting practice some night with a few beers in him.
Yeah, he's walking around the Highlands in his uniform.
I can see it.
That's such bull.
Now, look at your source. It was a girl who doesn't even care about baseball. Of course she's going to buy that's John Smoltz.
Well, we told her she should have said, no thanks, I don't like football.
And plus, John Smoltz is happily married. Everybody knows it because it's always on magazine covers. He's walking around Virginia Highlands in his uniform picking up women at Blind Willie's.
Well, just think about it then. John Smoltz has got some fool out there. Person
you
wearing
know
a
what?
Uniform.
Yeah, it's some guy who's got a
go,
uniform.
You can go buy a Smoltz jersey.
Yeah.
Can you just see Guido and his buddy? Hey, I tell you what, I'll wear my Smoltz jersey.
Yeah.
And you wear your cheesy sports jacket. Go over to that girl, tell her I'm Smoltz, man. Oh, that's hilarious.
No sale on that one.
That's funny. Thanks.
Let me give you a quick finish-up story on things I didn't tell my parents.
Uh-huh.
I was sleeping with one of my teachers in high school, and she almost got fired.
What?
Yeah, she almost got fired, and I almost got expelled. It
Wait
was a big
minute.
Deal.
Wait a minute. You were sleeping with your teacher?
Well, she wasn't one of my teachers, but she was one of the teachers at the school, and one thing led to another, and we just kind of started having a relationship.
What? How old were you?
I was 17, and she was late 20s, early 30s.
Oh, my God.
You know, I got to tell you, because a friend of mine did that, and that's happening shockingly more than I would have thought.
Well, because you think about it, teachers sometimes are 22 or 23.
Sure.
Yeah.
So you never told your parents, obviously.
No, I mean, well, we really got kind of stupid about it after a while. I was a drummer in the band, and she was just happened to... instruct the majorette, so she would go on band trips.
Oh, there you go.
And we ended up kind of doing the wild thing on the back of the school bus on the way home from a football game one night.
Wait a minute, with other people in the bus?
Yeah, but you've been in high school. You know, everybody in the back, four or five seats, is always under blankets and cuddled up and making out.
And and John Smoltz was driving the bus, right?
Yeah, in his race uniform, right.
she was just giving a little extracurricular lesson.
Uh-huh.
Well, that's what I tried to explain to the principal. I don't think he believes me.
Oh, my God. You talk about head of the class. But what I want to ask you is, do you want to tell your parents? Do you think that's something that maybe you'd like to come clean with?
I'd probably tell them. Yeah, it's no big deal now. But
Maybe
we could help
you. Maybe we could help you along there.
We'll pay for the call.
Where do they live?
Actually, they live here in town. But today's a good time.
Why not?
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think that's the kind of thing I want to tell my mom right now.
I think right now is an excellent time. It's a Friday. She's got the weekend to think about it.
I'll tell you what, if you guys can confirm the John Smoltz story, then I'll do it.
The John Smoltz story is not real. There's no way that's real.
But, Jimmy, you've got the cojones to ask him, don't you? At least to say, hey, we've heard this. You know, this is a rumor going around. And you could present it to him as if he needs to, find this guy. And
we're not going to waste John Smoltz's time with that kind of story.
That is such a retarded story. I mean, come on. Think about it.
Just think, if it had been somebody that just loved baseball and knew everything about it, what was he going to do? I mean,
all right, enough about the Smoltz. What is your parents' phone number?
No way, I'm not going to do that. I can't do it.
All right.
I'll go get my Smoltz jersey out of the closet and see you guys at Blind Willie sometime.
Gullible. See ya.
The Morning X with Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy. New Rock 99X. WNNX, Atlanta. It's a stomp weekend. Call and stomp.
The video conference room so we can get a view of this lovely Jimmy videotape. Now, this is from what year, 88?
88. We had a listener earlier call up who happened to be surfing his video. He's surfing the cable last night, and they were showing Scrabble on the USA Network, which I have said I was a contestant on Scrabble 8 years ago. Haven't seen this since. It may be the most embarrassing 5 minutes of my life.
Okay, now we haven't seen this yet. So.
No.
This is new to us, too. Here we go. Let's roll tape on the big screen.
Oh, even if things don't work out here today, I can go right over there and suck up to Charlie.
You bet. That's right.
Oh, man.
Who won the toss back stage? Let's go to the board, Jennifer. We're building on the letter S.
Jimmy's doing his letters in the word. Shy boy shtick up there.
Some of them are cooped up all day with a bunch of females.
Some of them are cooped up all day with a bunch of females. Okay,
ready?
Let's start with the 10.
She was not a very good player.
Eight.
I should have beaten her.
O and an S.
Place the O. And yes?
$500.
I had a feeling it was.
Up all day with a bunch of females.
It's a little bit early, so I'll take the six.
Did you know, Jimmy?
I think I guessed it after this one. I was pretty good on this one.
The tea looks interesting. And the F?
Oh, it's
prostitute.
Here you go. Well, must be my day. Yeah, I'll take a couple of tiles. You know what? There's no money over there.
You're
let me just guess that.
You're
doing stink. A couple of tiles? Hey, see, I just got it. I just won.
Good job.
Jimmy's trying to use this as an audition reel. I can tell already.
Oh, God. I was. I totally was.
Okay, let's start with a five.
All right, enough of you already.
It's smooth barren.
I and an E.
How about the E?
You know, she's very pretty. I'm surprised I didn't make a move on her.
Yeah,
some people do it. You know, she looks like, you know, today, like 1994. You look like 1973.
I do.
You're right. Stop.
He's got that cheesy Andrew Shue tie on that we always talk about.
I think I pulled two stoppers. I may need a nurse, so.
Well, oh, my God.
Hopefully you will. We've never had that happen.
The one and the deuce.
He's got the sheepish grin.
The Z. Well.
No.
No. That's unfair for me to do that.
Some people do it.
To keep up with the Joneses.
Let's try the S.
I snickered you, almost.
How old were you here?
You know, that's got to be...
what is that haircut the Eddie Munster do there?
I have to guess. Steel?
Steal.
To keep up with the Joneses, they steal.
Okay. Where did you get that?
On network TV, they steal.
He wasn't concentrating on the game, Barnes. He was too busy thinking of lines.
No. He was too busy looking next door at Jennifer.
Okay, now I think the next one is the rubber game.
Nine letters in the word. The clue is, sometimes he just can't seem to get his act together, Jimmy.
Not even going to make an attempt at this one. One and a four...
T or an L?
I'm sorry, the clue, please.
Sometimes he just can't seem to get his act together.
He's trying to get as much airtime as he can.
And the L?
No, stop her. Jennifer, it's over to you.
Okay, let's try the 8 and the 5.
She really is cute.
Will you leave that alone? She's gone.
She's gone. In the 80s. She's got four kids now.
Sometimes he just can't seem to get his act together.
Oh.
Dramatist?
That's exactly right.
Oh, she's kicking your ass.
She's kicking me.
She's not worried about money. She just wants to win. Okay, Jimmy, building on the letter T.
This is a simulcast of Scrabble from 1988, in case you're wondering what's going on.
And I am a contestant.
Is the contestant.
I'll take a tile. One and a six.
B and an O.
Oh, boy.
B, please.
No.
Where do those little things go when you drop them in there?
Okay,
just into a box.
Me.
Yeah, sure.
Did I just say something to her?
The F.
First position in the word. It's worth $1,000 and the game. Their fathers often urge them to tie the knot.
I'm going to have to place the O.
Oh, this, here it comes. This is where I totally choke.
I'm going to have to take the 7 and the 5.
Stop the tape. What do you think it could be at this point?
I didn't hear the clue.
Okay. Why?
Some of their fathers urge them to tie the knot. It is S blank O blank T blank.
Scouts.
Continue tape, please.
Jimmy, we did come back to you. There's only one stopper left, $500 possible.
It took you about a second to figure that out.
S or an O.
Their fathers often urge them to tie the knot.
See, you keep repeating the question. He's totally trying to get FaceTime. Totally. And what was the clue?
Can we see the choke, please?
There we go.
Yeah. That's it. Hands on your buzzers. Don't answer till I say go. We'll put the letters in place one at a time. Can't give you the last letter. Their fathers often urge them to tie the knot. Ready? Go. Jimmy. Oh, Jennifer, I'm sorry.
Did I buzz in?
Yeah, you got it.
Shouts?
All I have to do
is
answer.
All yours, Jimmy.
Spouts?
Spouts!
Spouts!
Oh, God.
No, wrong again.
I
so it spouts.
Maybe the worst contestant ever on
ever. Yeah. In the history.
total choke. The Morning X, Barnes, Leslie, Jimmy.
Could you be a bigger simpleton?
What a dork!
The Morning X with Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy.
Jimmy, for you, Daisy Turbo Spa helps turn your bath into a luxurious stress-relieving retreat. Full power, full featured Turbo Spa, furnished by Daisy.
99X.
80, I do believe I failed you.
Yeah. Right.
What is Ziggy short for?
It comes from Ziti, you know?
Zigalinda.
Oh, Ziti. That's one of my favorite dishes.
Yeah. Cindy, Vicky, Angie, and Ziggy on the phone.
All right, let's get to the punch.
All righty. This is an article in the 1995 winter issue of Mary Claire magazine. Claire magazine. It's for women.
Mm-hmm.
And it is it's Marie Claire's 1994 guide to sexual etiquette.
Okay.
You guys still in?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, then. What's the best way to bring up the subject of condoms before you have sex with someone for the first time? First, Leslie.
What's the best way?
Yeah.
Just bring it up. Be honest.
Oh, yeah. I see Leslie.
Okay, look, Leslie. Hey. Look, here. Let's set the
role
scene.
Role play.
Yeah. Ziggy?
Ask him if he has any.
Okay, Ziggy, here we are. You and I are making out right now. All right? We're getting naked.
You're dreaming.
Right, Ziggy? Oh, Ziggy. Okay. Now, here we
Very
go.
Good, Jimmy.
It's time
Very
to...
Good.
Oh, Ziggy.
And now I come over. Hey, what's going on in there?
You stay out of Ziggy and my house.
Okay.
Okay, Ziggy?
Huh.
All right, so here we go. We're naked now, you and me.
Okay.
What do you say to me? Ziggy, come on. Ziggy, I have to have you. Ziggy, I have to have you.
Do you want a condom?
Do I want a condom?
Just out of nowhere.
It's more like, where are the condoms?
All right, hold on a minute, Ziggy. Who else do we have?
Cindy.
Yeah.
Cindy?
What do you say?
Barnes, you role play with Cindy.
Cindy? Are you there?
I'm here, baby.
Come on, Barnes, get into it. You're
Turn down your radio.
Oh, okay.
Barnes has got to get in the mood.
Let me
turn the lights down.
Okay. Turn the lights down. You guys,
turn your radios off.
Hey.
Turn your radios off.
Okay.
Yeah. Which one of you guys is blaring your radio?
Me.
Down. Oh,
Ziggy, off. Turn off.
Turn off?
OFF.
Turn off.
To the left, all the way off. There you go. Cindy.
Oh, here, I got it.
What? It's a group.
Come on, go ahead. Make out. Start making out.
Cindy.
Yeah.
I can't hear you, Cindy. You have to speak
baby.
Up. See, I can't do this.
All right, Cindy.
Yes.
Oh, I have to have you, Cindy. Oh,
see,
Cindy.
You do this all the time, 1-900.
Oh, Cindy. Oh, Cindy. Cindy, you don't know what you do to me. Oh, come on. I have to have you. I have to be there.
Be there.
What do you say, Cindy?
Hey, baby, could you wrap that rascal?
Could you wrap that rascal is what Cindy said. Cindy.
Okay, let's go to the next question.
Sorry.
Next, that's okay.
How would you say it, Leslie?
Could you just bring it up? Right. Got a balloon?
All right. Is it okay? This is a quick yes or no. Is it okay to ask your lover for his sexual history?
Definitely. You should.
One at a time.
Vicky?
Yeah, it's okay. After a while, I wouldn't ask him the first time or the first date, but yeah, I'd get around to it.
Angie?
Maybe not right away in the relationship, but before we did anything.
Right. Cindy?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Ziggy?
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
Ziggy's just like, yeah, okay, whatever.
Now, let me ask you.
What if he doesn't want an answer, want to answer you? What if, you know, what if he says, it's none of your business? What do you do?
Panel?
I think you have to know if you're going to be intimate with a person.
Oh, yeah.
You have to know.
If you ask your significant other he doesn't want to answer you. What do you do?
Well, if you can't be open and honest.
You walk away? You say,
See ya.
I would
walk. Definitely.
Yeah, if I got to say, if I was
for
a girl.
For your own protection and health, yes.
If I was a girl and I asked the guy his sexual history and he didn't want to tell me, see ya, wouldn't want to be ya.
You always provide the resume, Jimmy.
But let me ask you this, ladies. What if the guy asks you for your sexual history? Do you give it up?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
You right
do.
Away.
Yes.
All right, let's go down the line. Ziggy, what is your sexual history?
Yes, I will.
Yes, I will.
No. Stop it. Okay. Any more questions?
No, I won't ask. I mean,
okay.
I won't
Yeah. Oh, Barnes. Hey. Huh? Here's a question, Barnes. Ladies. And Leslie.
Anything about 15-year-olds?
15-year-old. What's the correct way to reinitiate sex if you're not finished?
Oh.
I believe the question's on the table.
Oh, we should be asking you that.
Leslie. How often is
Leslie
the girl finished before the
Leslie.
Guy? How often is the girl finished before
okay,
the guy?
Okay, so you know would you saying? Repeat the question now? How to reinitiate
right.
How to get it going
intimacy.
Again.
Right. Okay, Ziggy
well,
and I
Well, I
have,
think that my answer would be actions speak louder than words.
I know, but we're looking, we're trying to, we can't.
I just said.
Always
yeah,
trying to
bow
out.
We can't see actions on the radio. You have to tell us.
A simple loving touch.
A touch with?
With your hand, a simple loving touch.
Vicky?
Leslie's right. Just get them back in the mood.
Cindy?
I think Jimmy wants details here.
Damn right I do. Cindy?
Kisses.
You want details?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, if I'm not already south, I would head that direction slowly.
You'd head south for the winter. Okay.
What?
You'd head south
we'd
for
head
the
south.
Winter.
That's right.
Head south to the north.
I want to save Ziggy for last. Who is we have Cindy, Vicky.
Vicky and Angie.
Angie?
It would involve my tongue. But I don't know if I can say where.
Go ahead.
Not Barnes. What are you doing here?
And Ziggy?
Ziggala.
I'll keep asking. I mean, call him and ask him to go back.
You call him up.
She got guys that come over to show home.
You call him and ask him to come back.
Okay.
Ziggy.
It's the Italian way.
I have got to meet Ziggy, I got to tell you. This is... All right, ladies.
Thanks, ladies.
Thanks,
hold
panel.
On. Don't go away. We'll give you a Morning X big shirt.
Ziggy. Mamma mia.
God, to think I was going to have sex with you. And it was going to be hot. Oh, like you've never had before. I'm talking steamy, sweat dripping down your back, neighbors pounding on the walls, illegal in 48 states kind of sex.
The Morning X.
Tomorrow at noon, Axel will be out at the Atlanta Beer Garden in Buckhead for Resurrection Sunday. Win tickets to see the specials at the Masquerade. Todd the Butler, your host for the best of Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy. A few minutes left. Norm McDonald will be next on the best of The Morning X.
Ordinary bees are nothing to be afraid of. It's the killers you gotta worry about. The big kahunas. The world's fiercest pack of motorcycle racers are swarming to Road Atlanta 98 for the Dunlop AMA Big Kahuna Nationals, May 29th through 31st. Your only chance in Atlanta this year to watch the top riders on the top bikes pursue the sweetest prize of all, the Big Kahuna. The pressure will be venomous, because Road Atlanta can make or break a team's entire season. Watch Gary Rothwell perform death-defying stunts. Check out the latest manufacturer's displays. And with big-screen viewing, you won't miss a minute of the action. And best of all, the Dunlop AMA Big Kahuna Nationals are the year's only two-point-paying races. Twice the reason to head for Road Atlanta, May 29th through 31st. For tickets, call 770-967-6143. Or buzz by any greater Atlanta Honda motorcycle dealer and avoid the sting of disappointment.
There are certain things that run chills up your spine, and the incredible savings at Goody's Moonlight Madness sale is one of them. This Friday and Saturday, there are literally thousands of values on clothing for smart shoppers like you who aren't afraid of a good buy. Shop the store's extended hours for Levi's denim shorts for men and ladies for just $21.99. Levi's denim shorts for boys and girls are $17.99. Levi's red tab jeans for men and ladies are just $29.99. When it comes to Levi's jeans and shorts, Goody's has the styles and prices you crave. But those are only a few of Goody's bone-chilling buys. It's the Moonlight Madness sale. Friday and Saturday at Goody's Family Clothing. where the prices are so low, it's insane.
It's the best of the Morning X with Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy. New Rock, 99X.
In January, production will begin on the seventh season of MTV's The Real World. The seven young people appearing in the series will represent different backgrounds, ages, religions, and sexual orientations. However, this year, they will share one trait in common. I will hate them. Playing in a music store in New York this week, Kenny G set a world record by holding a saxophone note for 45 minutes. While he did warn spectators that it would be quite boring, it should be noted that it is every bit as boring to hear Kenny G play different saxophone notes for 45 minutes. In overseas news, an attempt to lift the ban on gays serving in the British Armed Forces has been defeated in Parliament. This raises a difficult legal question. How do you exactly tell if a British guy is gay?
Hello, Norm McDonald.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Doing excellent. Good. How are you? Welcome back to Atlanta.
Yeah, it's great here.
This is kind of like we're not quite sure which what things we're plugging. If it's South Park, Norm McDonald's stand-up, or Dirty Work. It's
everything.
An amalgamation of
just everything.
The Braves winning streak.
The Braves winning streak. That's right. You know, I was mentioning before we went on the air, you just missed the Dalai Lama by one day, and I'm guessing he would have been more than happy to take a meeting with you.
Oh, yeah, that he's a God. Some people consider him God.
I know they do.
But not me.
No.
I consider him another foreigner.
He is a man in a robe. Yeah.
How long have you been doing the Dirty Works tour?
This is the first day.
This is it? This is the debut day in Atlanta.
That's right.
How many cities are you going to have to hop around to for this movie?
24.
How did this whole thing mesh with South Park and Dirty Work and all that?
Well, you know, South Park's a kind of a dirty cartoon.
Right.
Right.
And then my movie's called Dirty Work.
Gotcha. Do you like South Park, Norm MacDonald, on the record?
Yeah, it's funny.
How about off the record?
Did you ever watch it?
Yes.
You like it?
No.
So you're going through a whole episode
I mean,
then
what
tonight.
I say I don't like it, but I recognize that most of America likes
everyone
it.
But us.
Yes.
Yeah, that's very cool, actually.
Yeah.
Norm,
now, why do you not like it?
I just don't get it. It doesn't hit me hard. I mean, just,
I actually like
for,
it.
For me, I don't.
Fram.
I do like it. I like your humor because I find you clever.
You think okay. It's just easy.
It's just easy, you know, kids saying, you know, penis and bitch and fart and, you know.
Yeah.
I think it's easy, exactly.
Well, I'd rather never seen it.
Yeah. That's right.
Norm, what is your movie about?
It's about a dude that he can't, you know, keeps getting fired from his, I like saying dude.
Dude.
It's about a dude that keeps getting fired from his jobs, but he always gets back at the people that he gets fired from.
Uh-huh.
So then he opens a revenge for a hire business.
Sweet.
Yeah, well, he gets revenge on all the dudes.
Now, you have a pretty good cast in this movie.
Yeah, it's cool.
Who are you working with?
Don Rickles is in it.
Mm-hmm.
And crazy Chris Farley.
Right.
And Chevy Chase. And then crazy Artie Lang.
He's going
to be with me tonight at the gig.
Artie Lang.
You ever hear that dude?
No.
Who is that dude?
You ever watch the Mad TV show?
Yes.
Well, he plays the guy that is the white mama.
Dude.
You're picking up some posse from your competing old show.
Not bad.
That's right.
Hey, Norm, now we would be remiss.
Yeah, it's just very easy. Just sit.
It is you. It's Weekend Update Deluxe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What do you think of Colin Quinn now at the Weekend Update desk?
I haven't seen it since I left, you know.
Was he a writer with you on Weekend Update when you were doing it, or was it just you? Or
No, he wasn't a writer on Update. But when he came, I always like wanted him to do Update features because he was a, you know, like a guy that, mm-hmm. you know, those guys that sit beside you to do the things.
Sure, absolutely.
Co-anchor.
What?
A co-anchor.
No, not a co-anchor.
A feature.
A feature guy, okay.
A feature, yeah. Yeah. A dude that would.
Is
and then because he was like no, nah, he was like me. He wasn't like a sketch player. He was like a stand-up. Mm-hmm. But I always, you know, told him to come on and do stuff. I think, you know, he's a good choice.
I kind of like him. Yeah. I liked you better, but I do like him. Real quickly, first of all, Dirty Work opens when?
When does Dirty Work open, you ask me?
That's what I'm asking you.
your movie that you're starring
in. Hold on, let me ask Artie. He's in the movie, too. Hey, Artie, when does that movie open, man? June the 5th.
June 5th.
Excellent.
And, of course, tonight Norm is at the Roxy. Tickets still available for Norm McDonald. I will be there.
You're coming down?
Yes, I will.
All right.
I absolutely will be there. We need you for 15 more seconds.
That's it.
And this is something that we ask guests on our show to partake in.
It's easy. It's called the fish quiz.
I'm sensing a new champ right here. Fish quiz?
Fish quiz. Very easy, Norm McDonald.
You're from that part of the world where fishing is pretty big.
Yeah.
You'll have 15 seconds to name as many fish as possible.
Okay.
Anything that swims.
On your mark. Get set. Go.
Well, you got the halibut, the mackerel, the tuna fish. You got the salmon, the porpoise. You got the sturgeon. You got your, I already said mackerel. You got...
Six.
Oh, whitefish. You got whitefish. You got...
it's over, Norm.
That's okay,
idiot.
Norm.
It's Artie's fault. He started yelling different fishes that I'd already said into my ear.
Good luck with the show.
Okay,
thanks,
man.
Thanks for calling.
Norm McDonald.
I had his dream, you know. I had his dream last night. You ever have a dream, and then you wake up right in the good part of the dream, and you're back in your stinking life again? And, you know, and then, so you fall asleep, you try to re-dream it. Man, that never works. Always end up with some weird mutation of your original dream, you know? Like in the first dream, I was in a pool with Christie Brinkley, and we were swimming toward each other, and then I woke up. So I fell asleep again and ended up shooting pool with David Brinkley.
The Morning X with Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy.
Mike, oh, God, there's... Oh, turn it off. Let's cut it. Turn it off. I can't take it.
Wait a minute.
There's
I want to hear that goat slaughtering
goats
part again.
Goats over there. This is unbelievable.
And they're worshiping the devil?
Oh.
And that's what our young people are listening to?
This is the kind of thing that's wrong with America today, Mikey. The children who are listening to those people with their Satan worshiping and their devil music and slaughtering of the animals are the very people that we have to institutionalize by the time they're 14.
Some scary
Mikey,
stuff.
Mikey, we need to do something to turn these people around.
I think you need to turn that tape over to somebody.
I could give it to the authorities.
Somebody needs to investigate.
We might have to give this to the authorities.
Okay, now... Me, is it just me, but I hear this, I hear middle-aged man going through midlife crisis with small penis. That's what I'm hearing.
I see that. I felt bad for Mikey, his little assistant, because he was the guy that had to do that goat noise for 15 minutes.
Well, I have a feeling that he probably has him make that goat noise often when we don't know about, too.
JB.
And what is that relationship? Is that like his man boy? His little his assistant man child kind of... Batman and Robin, and we were never sure about that relationship either, you know?
Yeah.
Because Batman never had a date. And what I'd like to do now... Hey, Todd, come here. We're going to do a little Morning X quiz.
Okay.
Melissa from the newsroom, Todd,
here,
Doug.
Doug is in here with us. Doug, get on the microphone.
I want you guys all over on that mic.
Okay.
We're going to play a little Name is Your Buzzer. Okay, when you know the answer to these questions, shout out your name, and we'll see if you have the right answer.
Okay.
Now, the Kimmer on WGST, he thinks all of us and the listeners and the disc jockeys are what? We do what?
Melissa. Get stoned.
Now, if you did not take drugs... and you wanted to prove to somebody that you did not take drugs. What is a good way to prove to somebody that you do not take drugs? What is a surefire way
Doug.
Of proof?
Doug, take a drug test.
A drug test, okay.
Very good, Doug.
Now,
way to go, Doug.
What is, when a drug test is taken, how do they administer a drug test?
Doug. A urinalysis.
Urinalysis.
What did you call me?
Okay, now... to get a urinalysis, how does one give a urinalysis? They do what?
Doug, they go to the bathroom.
And where do they go into the bathroom?
Todd.
Specifically, Todd.
Test tube.
In a test tube, or a beaker, or a cup. Okay. I think we need to prove to
the Kimmer that we are all straight.
And have been.
I am now.
Whole lives.
That's right. I am now putting out to every single Morning X listener this, not proposal, but this mandate. I want you to send urine samples, your urine, to 1819 Peachtree, Suite 700, 30309. That is WGST, pee in a cup.
Okay.
All right.
That's fair.
Wherever it is.
Would you give me that address again?
Yeah, 1819 Peachtree, Suite 700, 30309, to WGST, to Kim Peterson. I want everybody to send a urine specimen to him. Now, people say, I don't want to go through the trouble. Okay, we're going to make it easy for you. This morning, we are going to have a big box in the lobby here at the station.
I see where you're going with this.
All right. I will take, let's say, the first 50 people after 9
sure.
who bring in urine specimens.
Sample.
We're going to give you a big shirt. Now, let me just, because Sarah up at the front right now is having a stroke. So let me explain the rules to this. It must be in a sealed plastic or glass container, sealed. Then I want you to wrap it in like a one of those little plastic grocery bags or something. And then just put it in something that I don't have to look at it.
Yeah, like okay. you would do at the doctor.
Exactly.
You know?
Don't do it up here in the office because I don't want her to be handling stuff with dribble on it, okay?
Put it in a little baggie.
Put it in a little baggie. Well, put the jar in a baggie. Don't pee into the little baggie.
Yeah, put the jar.
Hey, I got a bag of
pee. Put the little, like, container, Tupperware type thing, sealed, right. and then put it in a baggie.
And we're going to make a delivery from here as well over to the Kimmer at WGST. So I want him swimming in our urine, as it were.
And ours, too.
And ours, too. I'm going to, you know, in a cup back there. I was practicing all morning, you know, making sure. So, everybody, please send your urine to WGST 1819 Peachtree.
In care of the Kimmer.
In care of the Kimmer. That's right. 30309, or you can bring it to 99X after 9 o'clock today. You will get a big shirt if you're one of the first 50 people to bring us your specimen.
See, there's your incentive.
Right, because, you know, everybody calls up all the time, I don't want to get a big shirt. Well, here's how you can do it. Right? You know, put your hand in warm water and you get a big shirt.
The Morning X!
WNNX.
Atlanta.
At 99X.
Heaven.
Or hell. Weekend. From Doritos, pick your music. And 99X. The best of the Morning X.
Chicago to Soldier Field because it could safely hold more people. But since only about 20,000 tickets have been sold, concert promoters now say they're going to move this to like a mid-sized theater in suburban Tinley Park.
What were they expecting? I mean, 20,000 is a lot.
20,000 is a lot. Proceeds from the concert are going to the Make-A-Wish Foundation. This is the tour where they're giving 100% of the proceeds to a charity.
Yeah, 20,000 is about right, but
they think they're going to get 50,000?
Soldier Field holds 50, and 20,000 doesn't look like a lot when 30,000 seats are empty.
He built one in Poland. Now Michael Jackson is building a massive family theme park in Brazil. Officials in Rio de Janeiro say Jackson will pay out an estimated $800 million to build this amusement extravaganza. It will take up more than 1 million square yards of space and create about 12,000 jobs. It's building amusement parks all over the world.
It's the best place to lure in little kids, Fram.
Chinese Americans are allegedly upset about Disney's reworking of Mulan. Raymond Lee of the Foundation for Better Persons says the actual legend has Mulan being trained as a soldier by her father and rising to the rank of general. But in the movie, she doesn't know how to fight and winds up being taught by a tiny rapping dragon played by Eddie Murphy. I haven't seen the movie, but there has been some controversy.
Who's upset?
The Foundation for Better Persons.
The Foundation?
Chinese Americans.
Well, what? I don't understand why they're upset.
They changed the reworking of the movie. They changed the movie.
Whatever.
Late Night with Conan tonight. Look for a 99X band on. Fuel will be on. Oh, this ought to be interesting. On Politically Incorrect tonight, Mark Furman
Oh, that should be good.
Ray Manzarek, too, from the Doors.
You know what else is on tonight, Leslie? Get out the handkerchiefs. One of your and my...
what?
Your and my... How do you say that? One of yours and my...
One of yours and my...
And it's going to eat you up. Oh, I got my jello star spirit all over the floor. Come on, here, chicken heart!
Stuff, I had to leave it on her porch all weekend.
Oh, no.
Which today makes me shudder.
What'd you pay for the table?
I paid $25.
Okay, $25.
For the table, mm-hmm. And when I turned it upside down to tighten the legs because they were so wobbly, I realized it had a label and it was signed mm-hmm. by John Seymour of Boston. Well, not knowing who he was, I went to the library and did research and found out it was a big name.
Now, so why would you... Hold on a second. Now, if I did that and I saw a table signed underneath, I wouldn't even... I think some guy signed the table.
No,
whatever.
Usually when somebody signs something, it means something.
Well, I mean, my roommates signed their table, so I wouldn't take it home.
Signature means something.
I guess, so you must know a little bit about antiquing.
Well, I did. I could usually only afford the ticket to get into antique shows. This uh-huh. is how you get an education. You go first, and you figure things out, and you listen, and you learn. That's what you have to do if you have no money.
Oh, see, listening and learning, that's where Barnes and I...
Yeah, have,
you live and learn, don't you?
So you took your table.
I just really thought this thing had style. I thought, it's a total mess. And my friend, who was a decorator, said, it's not even going to hold a lamp. Are you going to pay $25 for it? Hmm. I said, sure. I said, this thing is just exactly what I want for my living room.
Uh-huh.
So... Having researched this name, John Seymour of Boston, I realized this man, it was a very famous cabinet maker, and it was also, it was made in 1795.
Wow.
So this is when he was doing it. And I also got the impression that since everybody that had that furniture called it attributed to, I realized that I had a kind of a prize here because... He never hardly ever signed anything.
Okay.
So here I had this thing, so I kind of kept it under covers, but I had a big dealer was told that I had it from Connecticut. She was big and very important, and she came all the way down with her person, her driver, to look at it, and she offered me any kind of a price, and that she would top anybody's offer.
Like what kind of money was she?
She didn't tell you what kind of worth it had, right?
She was very, very smug about this. She said, if you were going to sell it, how much would you sell it?
She wanted you to name the price.
At the time, was $40,000, and I thought, I'm going to give her a big number, and it'll wow her. It'll knock her right off, knock her off. It didn't. I said $20,000.
And she said, fine.
And she said, I'll top anybody's offer.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah,
so then what?
And so there I am with no money and no furniture, and I didn't take it. I mean, I didn't take her offer of any sort. I liked the table, and I wanted it, and that was my table.
Wait a second. Bucks, and you weren't going to bite?
No, I didn't care if she was offering me, you know, anything.
But for wait a minute, you had
didn't
no money?
Ask,
that was in 1965.
Wouldn't you ask, why would you offer me $20,000 for a table?
No. You had, in the back of your mind, you had to have known it was worth more.
No, you absolutely, what you do is you automatically know. What she said told me a whole lot.
Okay.
That it's worth at least 10 times.
So I kept still also, but I said, I'm not selling it. And she knew I wasn't going to sell it.
But at least the bells went off in your head knowing I've
then
got
something.
I said,
I really have something, and eventually maybe I can put one of my kids through college or buy a little house on the ocean, uh-huh. or, you know.
So
eventually,
then where did you take
I'm thinking.
It? Let's go up to present day when you went to Chubb.
The present day. Okay, I had it all those years, and I had thought of taking it to the White House or to...
The White House?
To the White House. And it belongs in the White House.
You were going to just drop it off on Pennsylvania Avenue?
Yeah, I was going to talk with those people. And these are things I had options to do in my mind. And the other option, if I wanted money, would be to go to Israel Sack, Inc. in New York, who are, well, the Pope is the next highest thing after him. So Israel Sack, you want to remember that
Israel
name because
Sack.
He
Sack.
Is very, very big in antique world.
Okay.
I didn't do that yet because right at that time, Chubb had decided to do something with this antique road show, which England has had for 20 years
right.
or more.
We've had Chubb on our show. Very nice.
Yep, and that was a good idea. And not only that, they came to New Jersey. So got up at 5 o'clock, took the thing in, and stayed there for quite a while, you know, waiting for somebody to see it. And when Leslie and Lee Kino, the appraisers, one was from Sotheby's and one had his private own outfit, they saw this and really, their socks, underwear, and everything fell off. It was wonderful.
What'd they say? How much was it worth?
$200,000 to $300,000
And you thought, maybe I'll auction
it.
I knew it was worth six figures when I took it.
And now, at this point, were you still thinking of just donating it to the White House?
No, I was thinking of I'm hanging on to it.
Uh-huh.
Smart.
So as soon as they mentioned $200,000 to $300,000 I knew economically our country is in such a situation, I thought this is the time, and gut feeling is what I use for practically everything.
Right.
And I thought, no, I can't take it home even. They asked me what I was going to do with it, keep it, sell it, whatever. I said, look, I just want to leave it here because it's too dangerous to take home.
Sure.
I don't want it in my house. But I had to take it home, and at that point, I knew I was going to go with Sotheby's and put it up for auction.
I just picture you walking around with this table everywhere.
Look at this thing. It's a little teeny
table.
So you go to Sotheby's, they put it up, and wow, what did it go for?
Yeah, it went for over $500,000.
Jeez.
Yeah, and it went for $541,500. And Israel Sack is the one who bought it. And he was supposed to be the appraiser the day that I took it. This is funny.
And they cut you a check for $541,000.
No, you got that on consignment when you do those auctions, right?
No. I got what you just said, except, that was including the buyers. The buyer's fee.
Well, what's the buyer's fee on an item like that?
How
does that work?
I don't know what number that is.
Sotheby's gets the percentage, right?
It brought it up to 541.5. And see, they had gotten in a bidding war. And he ended up with it because he wanted it, and he was bidding for a client.
So you got to put some kids through college.
No, they're all done with that. They are all finished. It's now mine, and I haven't got any husband.
Are you gonna buy something lavish? Are you gonna sit on it?
I'm gonna buy another table for about $2,000.
Well, you know, Claire, there's 35 years between us, but I'll bet we could make it work.
I'll try.
What that is, she buys this thing 30 years ago for $25 and ends up selling it for over $500,000.
Right.
A little junky
nice
little
score.
Table.
Little
and
patience.
I've been on 7 TV shows.
Look
yeah.
At you. You go,
Oprah,
girl.
And if I'm allowed to mention these things, Oprah and Good Morning America and a whole slew
in the
of
morning
other
X.
ones. And the road show, I just found out, my segment not only was shown here, but it was shown in Wales and England. And
Claire, you're a big star now.
I'm a celebrity.
You are phenomenal.
I think it's a riot, and I love it. I love it, and I have so much fun with this.
You're still going to yard sales, I presume.
I spent one whole day, Saturday, helping my friend with hers.
And you're going to take that $500,000, and your kids are out of college, so we still don't know. Did you buy a house? Did you?
Oh, no. I invested it.
Oh, okay.
There you go, Claire.
I'm a very shrewd Vermonter. Let me tell you.
Seems like it.
There's nothing worse than a Yankee trying to hang on to money.
Sounds kind of Martha Stewart-ish to me. I picture you in a nice garden,
And I have a beautiful garden, and I have a beautiful home.
Right. Yeah, Vermont, that's a beautiful part
Claire,
of the country.
Yeah, come on up.
Whenever you list the shows now, you list the Morning X, you say, I was on the Morning X, then you say Oprah.
Yes. The Morning X in Atlanta.
What?
The Morning X in Atlanta. Just remember that, okay?
The Morning Accident?
Yes.
Yeah,
the
exactly.
Morning Accident.
We are the Morning
Accident.
Exactly.
What's that mean?
That's perfectly
our show.
Right. The Morning Accident.
Oh, well, I love these shows.
Well, thank you, Claire.
Thanks, Claire.
And I enjoyed being on here, and I'll answer any other questions you want.
All right, thanks, Claire.
There you go.
Okie doke.
I picture
send
her.
Send us some
and
money.
Keep going to your garage sales, please.
Yes.
Leslie.
They're fun.
Just send us like $10,000 a piece.
Send us picture
okay,
of Claire.
So that's all you want?
Yeah.
How beautiful she is.
If you're in very, very bad trouble, see, that I expect to help people who are in bad trouble.
I am in trouble. I need a deck on the back of my house.
Oh, yeah, well, that's not trouble.
Yeah, because the grass is way too... I can't walk on the grass.
Okay.
Thanks, Claire.
Okay.
Claire. Nice meeting you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
The Morning X.
Thought, this is something actually... They're really walking around the park naked?
Oh, God, every year. Every year they do that.
Now, what's
stretch
the point
mark
of that?
For days.
What's the point of that? I can understand going out and marching for your gay pride, but do you have to go out there naked?
Oh, you have a problem with naked women, Barnes?
No, I'm saying, were there some there?
They're just trying... They're just trying to blend in with the rest of society.
No, their whole point is, what's the big deal? Men can take their shirt off. Why can't women?
See, that's stupid. That's where they lose me.
That's where they lose the credibility of the whole thing.
Absolutely.
Oh,
okay.
just, you have no idea. Who's going to care in that part?
Yeah, really, who cares?
Well, I guess you're right.
Who cares?
I'm just saying,
it's like, okay, folks, we are different, okay? We are different. Sexes are different, and it is okay for men to walk around the park and not women.
With
yeah,
their
but
shirts
during
on, their
gay
shirts
pride,
on.
When no man's going to look at them.
What was your favorite part of the weekend,
true.
Bob?
Well, sweetie, let's see.
God, what was that voice?
First of all, start from Friday.
Well, you know, I started culturally. I went to see a play. I went to see Annie Main, the gayest play ever made.
Right.
Where is that
Actors
showing?
Express.
Actors Express.
That was fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to the Heretic. Every queen from every square state in the southeast came.
Where is that Heretic? Where is that?
The Heretic. It's on Chester Bridge.
Okay, of course.
It's the hottest. It's one of the hottest dance bars in the city. The only problem with Pride is queens come in from, like, Alabama and Mississippi.
Queens from Alabama?
Full of attitude.
They have queens in Alabama?
Yes, who knew?
What kind of attitude?
Well, you know, like, I tend to think that small-town queens think, you know, I guess when you're in a small community, they get really, like, defensive.
Feisty?
Yeah, they're feisty. I still had a good time. I left with my teeth looking like an epilady. It was still a good weekend.
Mm. What, were you biting arms?
Mm. No, sweetie.
What did you do on Saturday?
Mm. What did I do on Saturday? Well, I went down in the park. You know, that's Dyke Day in the park.
Well, is Saturday? It really?
They have a Dyke March.
There are separate days?
Is that what they call it?
Yeah, there's a Dyke March.
All right.
That's what they call it.
And what is that? Just a
it's
bunch of...
It's a bunch of women that take their shirts off and run around and beat on drums.
What is Dyke short for?
What is Dyke
short
for?
Short for?
Lesbian.
Okay.
I don't know where that word came from.
Yeah,
that is a good question.
Is Dyke like?
Oh, that is a good question. I don't know where that.
I have no idea where that came from. Mm.
And then anything special
Dyke?
Saturday
well,
night?
Dyke is another way to. Well, anyway.
Anything special for Saturday night?
Well, I stayed in the park and watched. There was a lot of good groups in the park. There's a new group out called Halcyon. That's a local group. It was incredible.
Hey, I have heard
you
of them.
Stayed in the, so you pitched a tent and stayed in the park all
well,
night?
I went from tent to tent, sweetie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've been much in demand.
You're not one of those guys that sleeps behind the bushes over there at Piedmont Park, are you?
I don't sleep behind the bushes.
Uh-huh.
Mm. Were you in the parade?
No, I didn't walk in the parade, but I did watch. This year, it was, and I was conspicuously missing from the 99X van, I may add.
Well, what do you mean?
The 99X van went right by in the parade, and I wasn't on it.
Oh, you
well,
should have
Jimmy,
asked.
Why didn't you stop?
Well, I didn't even know you were having one.
We're in it every year.
I didn't know that. I don't pay attention. I'm usually in the parade in another area. I never even knew you had one. I didn't know a single person on it.
Talk
I
was to Jimmy. Not, he was you know, driving.
You were?
No, yeah.
I didn't see. I didn't know anybody on it.
I was wondering, I didn't know that we had one of those either, because had I known, I would have absolutely recommended that you be on that.
Who was in it? I didn't even recognize who was in it.
I don't know.
I think Yvonne came in from Nashville.
No, Yvonne, well, I know her. She wasn't there.
We probably hired some lesbians to drive it.
No, it was two black guys. I'd never seen them before.
Two black guys?
Anyway,
so
and then
it was
I,
a good
then,
weekend.
Yes, Josh Joplin was another good man that was good there,
right,
by the way.
Wait, hang on.
No, it could have been
Olympic,
anyone that stole it.
The Olympic backpedaling is now underway, everybody.
So would you say Josh Joplin?
Yeah, Josh Joplin was there. It was incredible.
Where were
great.
They were, and they are incredible.
Yeah, where were they?
They were they played the like the next to the last at the park on Sunday.
Right.
They were incredible.
They're a great band. I am a big fan of the Josh Joplin band.
Are you really?
Yes, I am. Josh.
They're doing their two acoustic shows this Friday night at Eddie's Attic.
And
they did several acoustic numbers almost.
That's
that were not just like with guitar. I mean, they were incredible.
Now, what is the deal with bands that get, they're only gay bands that play?
No.
I'm just asking.
They you have know, to be. They have to do play. It for free. Pride doesn't pay anybody.
Now, see, but although I had thought that in the past, I thought that, too. I thought that they
thought
were
that
mostly
it was someone who endorsed the
gay-flavored bands,
gay,
but I know,
gay,
like...
They're either gay or they're gay-friendly. And you
I
have to be able to... Will, you have to be willing to donate your time for free.
Right.
Gay or gay-friendly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Supportive. Like, the mayor
supportive.
Was there.
They're
as far
supportive.
As I know, he's not a queen.
Because, like, Josh is not a gay band. I mean,
I didn't
it's not
think,
like, you
I
know...
Think so.
Josh is not a gay band. Halcyon is not a gay band.
Right.
But, you know, whatever. The mayor is not a gay mayor, as far as I know.
Was the mayor out there?
He was there. He did a fabulous speech. It brought me to tears.
What was he saying?
He talked about the whole Kirkwood thing and how we're all got to get along and how he loves Queens. And
he did say
that. I can't even talk. Is that a quote?
That's a quote. I love Queens.
He loves Queens.
Are you crying?
Mm-hmm. It was fabulous. We have the best mayor in the entire world.
Are you really crying?
Mm.
Are you crying?
Yeah, I'm crying.
Why?
Because I'm so moved by the mayor.
Oh, that's good. And I saw the news footage of the mayor, and I saw that he was wearing the real short shorts with the, you know, rolled up cuffs, and he had a...
The mayor?
Yeah.
Blame him. Oh, yeah. 100 degrees outside.
He was wearing the tank top.
Well, you know, he often wears very gay clothes.
Really?
Well, I'm sorry. Barnes and I were having an off-air conversation there. Sorry.
As they always do. Sorry about that, Bob. Well, thank you for the update.
Well, sweetie, it was a gay pride weekend. I'm so proud y'all were interested.
Yeah, what are the hot gay restaurants now?
Oh, it's Cow Tippers for sure.
That's all. That's an old standby.
Cow Tippers, and, you know, I kind of think, I don't know if Einstein's is actually gay or not. Is that guy a gay restaurant?
It's the same owners as Cow Tippers.
Well, then it's queer.
Well, it's...
Yeah,
I think
right.
it is. It just caters to a lot of the gay community. I don't know if it's...
There's not a waiter there that touches the floor. They're all pansies.
Well, but...
that touches the floor.
Yeah, but what I mean is Cow Tippers is a gay place.
Oh, as queer as it can be.
I had no idea. I didn't know that.
Food there is great.
Cow Tippers, yeah.
It's always salty.
Big but beefy burgers there.
Yeah. But I think that Einstein's is just a very gay-friendly place.
Don't they own the Cheyenne Grill, too?
I never even heard of that.
Where's that?
It's over there by...
Peachtree Battle. I was there last week.
Isn't that what it's called? Cheyenne Grill?
Never heard of it. Peachtree Battle, yeah.
I think they're owned by the same people as well.
Never heard of it.
All right, Bob, thank you.
See you, honey.
We'll see you later, Queen.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.
You are a gay man.
Give this man satin undies, a dress, a sweater, and a skirt. He's the happiest individual in the world.
There's a museum going to be opening up in San Francisco, the Barbra Streisand Museum in San Francisco, of all places. It's true, the Barbra Streisand Museum, and the founder, a man named Ken Joachim, I'm probably not pronouncing that right, but he has spent his entire life savings, $200,000, to open up the Barbra Streisand Museum. Wouldn't it be easier just to tell your parents you're gay?
Hey, you think about getting a satellite dish, but you think you can't get all the local Atlanta stations like XIA, SB, Wagon, and GNX? Well, now you can with Dish Network. With Dish Network, you can enjoy all your favorite local channels and all the channels you get on cable, plus a ton more.
I'm very nervous. I'm on the radio. I'm nervous.
Go ahead, Paul. Talk to us.
It's too bad we don't know each other. We'd have a lot of fun. I have lots of fun all the time.
Listen to his laugh.
I'm feeling oogie.
Call Jimmy after the show. You guys should get together.
All right, go ahead, Paul. Wake up late as anything on Saturday to get out to the lake, Lake Lanier. I didn't make it out to Lake Lanier until like 4 o'clock. The whole family, they were like, where have you been, you know?
They were what?
I was late.
Uh-huh.
I was supposed to be there at like 11, and I got there at 4. So,
yeah.
The road trip up there was pretty good. No cops pulled us over. Me and the dog were drinking. We're having a great time.
You were drinking on your way up there?
Drinking on the way up there. Red Stripe, you know, we're ready to party, believe me. Ready to have a good time as a family. They don't drink.
Dude, are you for real?
Yeah, keep going. No, it really happened. And so I get up to the lake, I go swimming. Every time I jump into the water, my dog, my friend, she jumps in. She wants to drown me. She like almost drowned me like 5 times because she didn't have a life jacket on. I didn't have a life jacket on. We were worried.
Sid Brzezinski.
Huh?
Go ahead.
Yeah, it was scary. It was scary. But we made it. We survived. And then I got back and the party just never started. I got back to town and I went from pool to pool. I never slept and put off my residential apartment building maintenance program way off. The guy wants to move in today, and his apartment hadn't been painted one bit.
All right. I'm sorry. If you laugh one more time, I'm hanging this phone up.
You're the guy who wanted my place painting.
They didn't have a toilet. This guy, he ain't got no paint. I'm going to say that really quick. I'm getting started immediately. It's pretty much a big horror story, like you said. I'm nervous. You guys are nervous. We're in trouble. Oh, no. But it's over. Like I said, Independence Day is over. Now I'm ready to go back to work.
Paul.
Yeah.
Let's hope I can paint really quick.
Paul, you have a girlfriend, Paul?
Well, I have a good friend. She's out of town right now. But
what's the deal on that giggle? What's that all about?
What do you mean?
It's like kind of a...
A cross between like Jack Nicholson and somebody
and Jack
else.
Jack the Ripper.
Almost a stalker and a serial killer all rolled in one.
Together, we'd have good times.
Have you ever been arrested?
One time. Contraband item in MLK Federal Park.
All right.
Okay.
All right, Paul.
Party on, Wayne.
We'll meet you at therapy.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Seriously, in the history of our show, has there been a more annoying caller?
No, I don't think so.
That?
The Morning X.
Hey, a freak show.
99X.
New and exciting.
We're talking about this article in Maxim magazine, which has really, I mean, this is, I can't remember an article that's been talked about more, certainly not with Maxim, about the guy, Brian Zembic, who for a bet, for $100,000, he got breast implants for a year. Although it turns out he ends up keeping them in for more than a year. I guess he just liked them.
He still has them, doesn't he?
To the best of my knowledge, he does. But the article is in the Maxim magazine, complete with pictures of this dude.
Who looks like a lady.
Yeah, dude definitely looks like a lady.
He looks very proud.
The guy who wrote the article, his name is Michael Koenig. And we have him with us live from Los Angeles. Morning.
Good morning.
Does he still have those breasts?
He does. I squeezed him not long ago.
That's nice. Now, is this guy just a nutcase?
Yes, he is. You know, the thing about Brian that I don't think people understand, I've heard a lot of people in the last few weeks talk about, wow, would I do it for $100,000? No, man, I'd need $500,000, that sort of thing. The thing about Brian, I think, in retrospect, now that I've gotten to know him, he would have done it for $10,000.
Probably.
Is he? So this guy is a professional gambler, is that it?
He is.
So I'm guessing he's not a good gambler, because if he was a good gambler, he wouldn't need the money.
That's the other thing about Brian. He's one of these guys who never wants to spend any money. In fact, he's a very good gambler.
Is he just a drifter?
Yeah, you could call him a drifter. He's always crashing on somebody's apartment floor,
right,
or staying in a cheap motel. And frankly, he could probably afford a suite at the best hotel in Vegas.
How did you meet him?
Well, I write the gambling column for a magazine called Cigar Aficionado.
Oh, love that magazine.
One of the hottest magazines on the stands.
Well, I've been writing the gambling stories for them since they started up, and that brings me to Las Vegas frequently to research stories for my column. Hanging around there as often as I do, I run into a lot of degenerate gamblers, and in my network of reprobate friends, they said, hey, have you heard about this guy? He plays poker over at the Mirage Casino. I've heard that he made this bet. I said, come on, that can't be true. They said, no, it's real. Go check it out. Well, I finally tracked him down after about 2 months of calling around, and like we said, he's a drifter, so it's very hard to find him. Once I did find him, he was actually playing in a poker game. I was in Los Angeles where I live. I got on a plane. I was there the next day, and I met the breast man.
You just walked up and saw this guy sitting there. Was he wearing a bra?
He was. You know, you can't really tell if he doesn't want you to tell. He can wear baggy clothing.
Sure.
And when he's gambling, when he's playing in poker games, he generally does not accentuate his bust line. Sort of looked like a regular guy who maybe did a lot of bench presses.
So in other words, he's a man with breasts, but at least he's tasteful about it.
Did he have to use part of that $100,000 to get the breast implants?
No, in fact, this is, again, the whole Brian syndrome. He easily could have afforded to pay the best surgeon he could find, you know, $4,000 or $5,000 or whatever it costs these days to get implants. But why spend money? He played the doctor a game of backgammon instead.
And won. Oh, my God. I'd like to meet that doctor.
Yeah.
So he gave him implants.
Oh, man.
Indeed.
So he's a 38C, and
he had no problem with you writing about the story.
Yeah, did he, at any point, was he resistant?
Not at all. Again, the other thing about Brian is that he, not only being the cheapest bastard in the planet, he's also something of a egomaniac. I guess we all are. You know, we all like to be talked about and have our name in the mm-hmm. media. And as you've seen in the last couple of weeks, everybody is talking about him.
Is he a heterosexual?
Very heterosexual. Very. And one of the most entertaining things you can do is hang around with Brian in Las Vegas. Just keep your mouth shut and hang around and see him work his magic with the ladies.
I'm going there on Monday. I'd love to hook up with this guy.
Well, when we get off the air, I'll give you his number, and we'll see if he'll take you around.
So, you know, in this article, now, a couple things, background information. I thought this was very interesting. The article about Brian, although it's in Maxim, tell the story that you told to us off air, that this was not originally supposed to appear in Maxim.
It wasn't. As a matter of fact, it was for another men's magazine, which will go unnamed at mm-hmm. this point. They had assigned the story, and it was all ready to go. They had photos done by a very famous photographer who shoots for Vogue and fashion magazines.
Oh, somebody like Herb Ritz or something.
Somebody like that.
Yeah.
And they had these fancy photos, which I must say I didn't think really went well with the story, because they featured Brian in stuff like a corset. And,
yeah.
I mean, he basically looked queer. But anyway, they had these pictures done. It was all set to go. A week before publication, they called and said, look, the publishing side, the people who control the ads, are extremely nervous about the story, and they've insisted that we kill the story and not run it.
Wow.
I campaigned as strongly as I could. I told them they're making a big mistake. The story is just going to blow people away. And they're not going to lose ads. They're going to get ads.
How could you have a men's magazine and be that conservative?
Yeah.
I don't understand that.
I think it's called idiocy. Anyway.
So what? No. Yeah. So you told them, so you fought them and said you're making a big mistake, and you walked out the door, took it to Maxim?
More or less, that's what happened. The editor-in-chief of this men's magazine really did want to publish it, but the bean counters and ad mm-hmm. people told him you can't do it. So he said, look, go ahead, please publish it elsewhere. He wanted the world to see the story because he loved it. So I took it to Maxim, and
wild.
They mm. recognized a media frenzy in the making.
Who bet him the $100,000?
A guy who, in the story, we call Jobo. He did not want his real name in there, but Jobo, as I described in the magazine story, is one of the world's biggest backgammon players. And a dear friend of Brian's.
You know, you mentioned you worked for, you're the gambling columnist for Cigar Aficionado. After we read this story a couple weeks ago, we posed the listener to the question, this question to our listeners: what is the wildest dare you've ever accepted? And we got some good ones. You know, a guy ate a dog turd, and you know, some guy ran on, I think, didn't some guy run on stage during a Broadway play or something like that?
Oh, Lord.
I'll tell you one that we're going to take out of this column and put to use at some point, is the wearing the Spam suit to, like, a ball game or something.
Love that one.
Like, that'd be cool to wear a Spam suit to a game in August at Turner Field.
I'd just be afraid the fly ramifications would scare me.
Well, that's the whole thing. Now, you're writing a book right now, yeah?
Indeed, the this story, The Man with the $100,000 Breast, is the title story of a collection of my gambling stories called The Man with the $100,000 Breast and Other Gambling Stories.
What are a couple of others that stand out to you that you can recall?
Well, one of them that I really like, and this is a true story that will touch the hearts of all degenerate gamblers everywhere, is a true story about a man who came to Las Vegas with a borrowed stake of $10,000. He scrabbled it together off a friend, and he ran that $10,000 into $17
million.
Wow.
True story.
What kind of chunks of betting from the beginning?
What was he playing?
He started out playing, ironically, billiards. Which is not a legal game in Las Vegas, by the way. You're not supposed to be betting on it. He's a very good pool player, so he ran his stake up there. He moved to poker, then to the craps table, where he was legendary for having sessions where the swings were in the seven figures. He'd win $1 million, he'd lose $500,000, he'd win $2.5 million. I mean, it was great theater when this was going on. And then he went back to poker. He played all the big names in poker in head-on-head matches, and he beat every single one of them. Let's put it this way. I'd like people to read the book to see how it turned out, because he didn't end up going home with $17
million. One of the other, and I'm sure he played Gabe Kaplan in that poker game, you know. What, didn't we just read that, Ben Affleck or
Ben Affleck
Ben, or was it
Matt
Damon?
Damon.
Matt Damon.
They
played in fact,
in the...
I played in the World Series of Poker this year. I made it into the finals, and Matt Damon was seated two tables behind me, and he's a nice guy. I've worked with him before on another gambling story because he's got a poker movie coming out. And
that's
he's a
right.
nice guy. I've got nothing against him. But honestly, I could not wait for him to get knocked out of the tournament.
Why? Too much tension on him?
Jesus, there had to be 40 cameras surrounding the guy. And if you guys have ever played poker, you know, you need just a wee bit of concentration.
We've played a little.
Yeah.
We need to play more often.
I love playing poker.
I love gambling.
Have you talked to the $100,000 breast man recently?
I talk to him virtually every day.
Every day?
Every day you talk to the dude?
You guys become good friends?
I wouldn't say good friends, but Brian lives in one world. I live in another world, but I guess I can sort of bridge those worlds for him. Right now, there's all sorts of interest from Hollywood producers and television shows,
I'm sure.
And he doesn't know how to deal with any of this.
Right.
I live in Los Angeles. He calls me frequently. Look, this guy has offered me this, this, and that. What should I do?
You could represent him.
Well, we actually got somebody who knows how to deal with that to represent him. Brian never listens to anybody, anyway. But
when will your book be out?
Book will be out in November, just in time for all your Christmas shopping.
Oh, we love that.
Answer
this question real quickly, and this is the question that whenever you talk to, you know, professional gamblers, what is the game in Vegas with the best chance of winning, and what is the game in Vegas with the worst chance of winning? I've read this, but I want to hear it from the horse's mouth.
The game with the best chance of winning...
Your best odds are at what game in Vegas?
If you play expertly, blackjack.
Right.
The worst game you can possibly play in Las Vegas is... I'm going to qualify this. The worst game off the top is keno. The worst bet you can make in Vegas is the $1 jackpot bet on Let It Ride and Caribbean Stud Poker.
And what about the slot machines?
Slot machines are just for idiots anyway,
right.
but they're not the worst games, but they're just long-term losers.
And I read once that, like, with Keno, nobody in the history of Vegas has, like, ever won the big jackpot of Keno.
I mean, you read that in my gambling column, as a matter of fact.
Probably.
Did I? What, was it in your column?
Yeah,
possibly.
A few months ago, I wrote the five best and the five worst games that you can possibly play in the casino. That was the column, and I mentioned in the Keno section that the 20 out of 20 jillion-dollar jackpot thing that they offer has never been hit.
Yeah. If you've got some money and you go and play blackjack, you can run it up. I mean,
yeah, the only problem with that is... the casinos are very paranoid about expert blackjack players. It's this sort of irony in Vegas. You're welcome to be there as long as you're losing. They like to tell you, sure, we like winners too, but they don't. They
of
hate
course they
well,
don't.
When you say
They're
expert, not... are you talking about card counters and stuff?
Yes, I am.
Are you a card counter?
No comment.
I could never count.
Do you? Maybe you can comment on this. Have you been asked to leave casinos?
Yes, I have.
Wow.
Because you're winning too much.
Not even winning too much. I mean... more the way I'm playing. Let's put it that way.
Ooh. Okay.
Yeah.
See, I don't get how that works with the five deck shoe or whatever.
Well,
how
you can. It's very. That's why you always look for the one deck shoe. I'll go downtown to the horseshoe,
mm-hmm.
where I can get one deck as opposed to playing at Bally's with five decks or wherever Caesars. Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you a little.
It's not that. Correct me if I'm wrong. It's not that hard to keep track of cards when you're playing one deck.
You are correct. In fact, to be honest with you, it's not that hard to keep track of cards when you're playing with 6, 8, or 49 decks. It doesn't matter the number of decks as far as keeping track.
But it's the odds.
The system is very easy. The fact is, with more decks,
right.
The power of your
right.
of your card counting is diminished.
Well, we need to have...
But who needs to count cards when you've got right?
Exactly.
Yeah,
that's the phrase. That's the phrase that pays.
Who
Michael,
needs to count
we'll have
cards
to...
when you've got. T-
right.
We'll have to call you back sometime.
I'll look forward to
okay,
it.
Okay, very nice. Michael Koenig's column on the guy who got breast implants for $100,000
is in Maxim this month. Thank you very much. We'll talk to you later, Michael.
The Morning X with Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy.
What we do want is the National Park Service to manage those animals.
99X.
Well, that's it for yet another edition of The Best of Barnes, Leslie, and Jimmy. The Best of the Morning X, brought to you by McDonald's. Stop by today. Get the delicious chicken biscuit for just 99 cents. Beginning Monday, The Morning X will have your first chance to get the new Beastie Boys CD and qualify for the trip to the Reading Fest in the UK, plus movie passes for Disturbing Behavior and tickets for July Rocks at Fernbank. Have yourselves a wonderful weekend. We'll see you on Monday.
Beyond the fame, the excitement, and the money live the real stories of rock and roll. You'll only find them in one place. VH1, Behind the Music. This Sunday, between the blues.
They thought it was a riot that this little redheaded 19-year-old girl was playing slide guitar like a man.
And the booze.
Yeah, it was partying with the best of them.
Bonnie Raitt gives VH1 something to talk about.
She probably knows more dirty jokes than I do.
This Sunday, live the rhythm and blues lifestyle with Bonnie Raitt.
I'd like to be a tough little rebel all my life.
Behind the spectacle, behind the smiles, behind the pain lies the real
little place, man. Nothing to do in there. Not a thing, man.